SQL as a programming language. This is more like the discussion on Fortran or C programming, so you'll find similar structures and so on. What we have seen earlier were simple examples just to illustrate the power of SQL, but this is formal SQL. First of all, just like any other programming language, you can define attributes in terms of the type and range of values which it will hold. The range of values that an attribute can hold is actually the domain. SQL provides for intrinsic domains needed for information systems, and additional domains can be defined. Here are the SQL domains or SQL data types. Numeric. Numeric can be integer or it can be written as even int. It can be also written as small int. Integer and int, small int, are the two categories which are exactly same as the integer of your conventional programming language. So when you say integer, it is either a 32-bit number or a 64-bit number or a 16-bit number, which is machine-specific implementation, etc. But if you define the domain as numeric, then it permits decimal arithmetic properly and exactly. And numeric is defined as precision comma scale. So numeric 4,2 would mean a 4-digit number with an implied decimal point before the two digits on the right. So consequently, you can represent numbers like 38.52 minus 69.13. A sign comes by default with any numeric. But you cannot store 176.2 exactly. You cannot store 9.254. It would be stored as 9.25. 4 will be lost. Okay? This is all common sense. But numeric is a decimal data type available. There is an approximate numeric domain. The approximate numeric domain consists of real numbers, as we call them in conventional programming, floating point. So these can be defined using the term real, where the precision is implementation defined. You can say double precision. Typically, for example, in a 32-bit machine, the double precision floating point representation will be 64 bits. Okay, and that would be a floating point double precision representation. Again, it is implementation defined. But if you say float followed by precision, it allows you to define precision. Please also note, let's go back to the previous slide. Suppose I say numeric 25,2. So I am talking about 25-digit numbers. Or 112,2. This implementation is done by software. So this can actually be much larger than the limited capability of the machine. Okay. Similarly, when you define float, and you define a much larger precision than what is ordinarily available on the machine, is the job of SQL engine to convert. Depending upon the particular SQL product, it might say that the maximum limit for this machine is this, etc., etc. Okay, but these are the features which are available. Character strings, we talked about them. You can say either character or char, which means x is the maximum length of the string. And if there are smaller strings as values going into any one thing, they will be padded with blanks. Character varying or varchar are smaller strings. These are stored as is, meaning three character string will be stored as three characters. In actual practice, just as in C, a string is stored which is a null terminated string. So if there are five characters, actually you require 6 bytes for storage. Something similar is done by the database, but that is internal. We need not worry about it. Okay. There is a thing called national character. National character in bracket something something does not generally translate to bytes. Ordinarily, byte is 8 bits, is a representation for a character. But a national character could be 16 bits. For example, Japanese character set, it would require 16-bit representation. Okay. You can also define bit strings. Bit strings mean 0001011111010101010, large amount. What is this bit string? Bit x or bit varying x, where x is the maximum length of the bit string. Where do we use bit strings? Typically, we use them to store very special data as a column in the table. Digitized fingerprint of an employee, digitized voice of a person, digitized maps, a digitized voice or a video film, a digitized video film. You will notice that each one of these actually are a sequence of bits. Okay. For example, for a digital image, okay, there will be pixels or picture points, and each pixel will be represented by grayscales or colors or whatever. And each pixel will have either 8 bits or 16 bits or 24 bits, 32 bits associated with it. And there will be as many pixels in a row as there are place and then so many columns. But ultimately, if you go row-wise, you will have a huge sequence of bits. You take a video film, depending upon the video encoding that you use, different bits will mean something different. Some bits will mean pixel values, some bit will mean indexing thing. Essentially, it's a bit stream. There is no programming language which can interpret these bit streams meaningfully. So there has to be some other program which interprets this. But if you want to store them, ordinary ways to store them is a file. So for example, you will say, digitize voice of Fatak, digitize voice of Prasada, digitize voice of Professor Umesh Bellur, digitize voice of Zubin. If there are 5,000 people, you will have 5,000 files. But look at the way you will work with them. Suppose you have an application in which you want to, the moment that fellow's name is flashed or you type in something, the voice is heard. Now what you have to do when the name is flashed, if you have stored all 5,000 files separately, at most you will store the file names inside the columns. So you, from SQL you will get only a file name, then you will have to go somewhere else, start another program, open the file name, open the file, do something. Instead you can integrate all of this, you can integrate that special interpreting program as a part of your application, and from the column itself you can extract the bitstream and directly give it to that special application. So these are some of the specialty things which are available. Date time is a very special SQL domain. It does not exist in any programming language. It permits you to store date and time values, and more importantly, it permits you to do date and time arithmetic, which is not possible without writing special programs anywhere else. For example, you can have an attribute of the type date. It will store the year, month and day. So date is 2006-03-27. This is one format, 27 March 2006. Okay. Internally, the date is not stored like that. DDYYMM, okay, DDMMYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYYMMDD, etc. are external formats. Internally, the dates are stored in a very special form, it's a sequence of bits. The SQL engine has the ability to interpret what that bitstream means. The SQL engine has the ability to add, subtract, etc. As far as you are concerned, you'll get the correct date arithmetic. Time is another thing. Time can be written also as time P. If you just write time, it will have a time in hour, minutes and seconds. But if you write a P, it defines the number of fractional digits for seconds. For example, if you say time is 14:35:05.385. This is an external representation in SQL of the time. This is the string you write. It means 14 hours, 35 minutes, 5.385 seconds. You can prescribe P to be any number, but ultimately the maximum that you will get will be the ability of the computer's clock to give so many fractional digits after that second, for that second, right? This is extremely important in most information system applications, as you can guess easily. The ability to store date and time as special types and the ability to do arithmetic. There is another domain called timestamp. Timestamp is a combination of date and time. So timestamp externally denoted like this. So 16-1-2006, 14:35:05.385 is a value. This is date and this is time. Where would a timestamp type attribute will be useful? Alarms, logs, when did this transaction happen? Why would this be very valuable, particularly up to milliseconds and all? Are you familiar with the notion of trading on the stock exchange? Day traders, buy, sell, buy, sell, buy, sell. Thousands of people are doing it. The back-end system in the stock exchange is required, okay, to process these orders exactly in the sequence in which they come. So every time a transaction data comes, the first thing that the server does is associates a timestamp. Even if a few milliseconds earlier something has come, that is first, this is second. Railway reservation system, timestamp would be important. And as someone said, auditing and so on. You can add interval to date time. and complete calendar logic is implemented by SQL. This is the characteristic of SQL. Null values. You are familiar with null values? We briefly discussed them. There are two flavors. Value is not known or value is not applicable. We discussed this also. Some of you may not remember because you did not attend the first session. When you see the audio visual for that session, you will find that out. For the benefit of those, I will mention this again. Any attribute is normally expected to have a value. For example, a name will always have some string. Roll number will always have some string. But CPI will have a value only when you obtain a CPI after your first exam. During the first semester, most students don't have any CPI. Would it be all right to insert a value 0 there? No, because 0 is not the CPI. So that time, the value is said to be null. That means it is not known. It could also be not applicable. The example I had given is that suppose you are putting an employee database, and in that employee database you say one attribute which says married or unmarried, so M or U, one character. And then there is another attribute which says number of children. Now, you can't say unknown really. Mostly in India at least you will say that is not applicable. Because if somebody is unmarried, not supposed to have children. Okay. The solution to represent null values is to use special values which are normally not used. So you use 0, you use minus 1, you use star, 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 etc., etc. So in a name string, for example, in a file, if you store names of people, somebody's name is not known at this time. Okay, you don't have that information. So you put stars. But now, any program which looks at that data will have to remember that if I see stars, that means that fellow's name is not stars. Fellow's name is not known. Now, this is silly because different programmers may choose different things to represent null value. Consequently, instead of making different choices and complicate the life and again requiring some special programs to return to interpret this, SQL said, I shall have a special way of handling. The solution is to use a flag with every data item. So if you have 5,000 students, if you have 10 attributes for each student, and if out of those 10, say 7 are nullable, that means they could have null values, then the space required to store each of those 7 attributes will be the normal space required by the specification, integer, numeric character, and an additional flag. And depending upon whether that flag is 0 or 1, it will mean that the value is null or non-null. So if the flag is 0, say it's null, no matter what that storage space in the disk or memory contains, it is to be interpreted as null. Is Ravi CPI 9.3? If it is null, what is the result? There is a problem with null values. Any comparison that you make ordinarily, is CPI greater than something? Is his marks equal to those marks? All these if statements result in true or false. All of you are familiar with that logic. Any programming language will say that. You know, a decision box, condition, true, you do this, false, you do this. Now, what do? You don't know whether it's true or false. If you are making a comparison with a value, and another value, and if one of the value is null, the comparison does not result in true or false. The comparison is unknown. There is a third logical value that is being now generated because of this peculiar thing. You are familiar with the truth tables and or not truth tables. So true and true is true. True and false is false. True and unknown is what? False or unknown is what? Because in SQL statements, you will write conditions. And if these conditions involve one fellow who is a null, then you have SQL has to know what is to be done. This is the basic query structure. Every SQL query as such, will always start with the word select. It will list columns. Then it will have word from. Then it will list tables. And then it will have the word where. And it will have a predicate or a condition or a complex condition. And it will end with a semicolon. As I said the other day, every SQL statement is a complete program in itself, does certain functionality. Of course, you can have multiple SQL statements combined to form a transaction or whatever. But usually, an SQL statement, and as we shall see later when we discuss subqueries, could have a variety of things inside. Select A1, A2, something, AN from R1, R2, something, RM, where P is a typical query. And this is equivalent to saying, form a cross product of R1, R2, R3, Rm, do a selection sigma over the predicate P, and finally project A1, A2, A3, An, whatever are mentioned. This is understood, this is very clear. The cross product is implied here. There is a sigma P. You will now appreciate by the previous lecture that this P must include some joint conditions, otherwise it will not make sense. Otherwise you are talking about so many cross products, I mean whatever number of tables that you have mentioned, you will have a problem. Okay. But this is the general formal format of an SQL statement. The predicate P is basically of the form some value expression, an operator and a value expression. The operator is all the comparison operators, greater than, less than, greater than, equal to, less than, equal to, not equal to, standard comparison operator. And value on this side, value on this side, value expression. Value expression means A multiplication B divided by C or 3.8 into something, whatever. It's an expression. You are all familiar with normal expressions and comparisons. So SCPI greater than 9.3 is a valid expression. Reg.sroll equal to student.sroll is a valid expression. You are testing equality of these two. And all combinations of AND or NOT, etc. available. Consequently, the predicate can be as complex as you want. The only requirement is that whatever are the attributes that appear inside the predicate, they must be meaningful in the context of the relations from which you are doing any selection. There could be complex predicates which are written using AND or NOT. So CPI greater than 7.5 and S hostel equal to 8 is a valid predicate. So you can build complex predicates. We have seen this example last time. There is a word distinct which eliminates duplicates. You will recall our discussion on projection where we said that projection in SQL, if there are 5000 rows in a table and you project hostels, you will actually get 5000 values when there are only 12, 13 distinct hostels. But SQL provides for the word distinct. So it says select distinct SH from student will give you only distinct value of S. In short, this is exact equivalent of a projection in terms of mathematical relation set theory. This is something which is special. Most of the time when you select something from the table, you don't want to display that result in an arbitrary form. You would like to order that result in some form so that it is readable and more meaningful for people who are reading that table. Consequently, there is a statement, there is a clause which says order by. Order by effectively sorts the resultant row. For example, select hostel name and SCPI from student will give you 5000 rows containing name of the student, his or her hostel and his or her CPI. However, if arbitrarily that data is presented, you can't really search easily. Our mind is tuned to binary search. Any list should be sorted list. So if you say order by SH ascending, SCPI descending, what it would mean is that all the rows will be first ordered on hostel. So all people from one hostel will appear first, since we are saying ascending, then hostel 2, then hostel 3, then hostel 4. Within one hostel, this is called the secondary key of sorting, this is the first key of sorting or main key of sorting. So first all hostels, within one hostel, hostel 1, all students in descending CPI, so the topper of hostel 1, then next, then hostel 2, topper, etc. Of course, this is an example, wherever it is meaningful, you will all agree that sorting is absolutely required. Any idea how do you do that in C or Fortran? You will have to either call a package which does that sorting. COBOL is the only programming language in which sort statement as a part of the language exists. SQL obviously permits that because it is meaningful for doing anything that you wish to do. There are correlation names. These may not make sense to you. Select distinct S, SH from student as S, where S dot S name is Ravi. This looks like a funny query. Imagine if I don't use S. Suppose I said select distinct SH from student where S name is equal to Ravi. The query will still be valid. This query is artificially written to illustrate that I can associate an arbitrarily chosen name with any table and use that name instead of the original table to qualify the attributes of that. So when I say from student, I could have said student.sname. I could have said student.sh. That is standard. But if I say from student as s, what I am telling the SQL engine is, look, I mean the student table. However, in my query, wherever I use the word s, take it to be same as student for this query. So I am correlating s with student. That means anywhere else I say s dot something, s dot whatever, it is same as student dot. Why would I do such a silly thing? I can use the main name itself. The purpose is not abbreviation. The purpose is something different. It is useful if the same table plays two different roles in a query. Later on we'll see an example in one tutorial where you have to do what is called self-join. You have to join a table with itself. Now, how do you join a table with itself? So can you say select range comma range? Doesn't make sense. There you will say select range as A comma range as B. Mathematically, the SQL engine treats A and B to be two separate copies of the same range table and does whatever operations you say. We shall see later why such things are useful. But there is a provision. The word as is optional. So I can just say from student S. Would it take these two as two different tables? No. If there are multiple tables, they have to be separated by a comma. Go back to the previous slide and see this. If there are multiple tables, they have to be separated by comma. But if I say from R1 A, R2 B, that means A is a correlation name for R1, B is a correlation name for R2, etc. Set functions. There are another favorite requirement of information system builders like us. We not only want to arrange data, we also want to calculate aggregate functions. We want to calculate averages, we want to calculate sum, we want to calculate maximum, minimum. All these functions are called aggregate functions and are provided for in SQL. Count is one aggregate function. Count just counts the number of rows selected. Please note that SQL ordinarily gives you a set and you would like to know how many elements are there in that set. 16, 15, 5000, 10,000. That will be given by count. Max, min, average, sum, etc. are the aggregate functions which are conventional. All these functions are always evaluated over a set and they always result in a single value. So count will work on a set of whatever, 10,000 tuples, the value will be 10,000. Sum or max operates upon 5,000 tuples. What will be the result is the maximum value of individual elements of all those 5,000. Common sense? The way you use them is as follows. Count the number of students taking CS634. Select count star. This is the way you specify. Count star means all the elements which are selected, that is all the rows or the which form the set of reserve from student comma range, where student dot s role equal to range dot s role and C code is equal to CS634. So this will give you the number of students who are taking this. Number of hostels, select count distinct SH from student. Notice the use. I am selecting from student, I am doing actually a project. I want to count only the distinct hostels. So the parameter for count is distinct SH. So I will get the number as 13, provided of course that at least one student from each hostel is there. That is obvious to you, right? Highest CPI scored by any student. Select max SCPI from student. Obvious usage, so aggregate functions is a very straightforward and simple concept. Min is like max. Curiously, you can use min and max in a single query. Find highest and lowest CPI. So you don't have to write two different queries. You can say select max SCPI, comma min SCPI from student. You can actually also write comma AVG CPI or average. Because in a single scan, all of these things are done anyway. You can write a program to find maximum as well as minimum in a single scan of data. Same logic applies here. For illustration of some of the queries, we define an additional table. We have defined student table, course table, and reg table, which is a association table, right? We now define a faculty table. Create table faculty. Faculty name, varchar 40. Faculty age, numeric 2. Faculty salary, numeric 7,2. And department number, numeric 3. We artificially say that in our academic environment, departments are not named, but they are numbered. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 85, whatever. And we imagine that, we'll see that, is there any problem, logical problem in this data definition? Do you find something amiss, something not very good actually, if these are the attributes? Which is that?
Age.
What is wrong with age? Age is a derived attribute. Age is not a natural value. Age may be correct at the time when it is entered, but 1 year later it will definitely be wrong. 1 year ago it would not have been listened. Such derived values are normally not designed as a part of my table design. This is just an example, but it illustrates the point. Anyway, with this table now, we'll try to form, with this and all other tables, we'll try to form some query. Here is another table, department. Teachers belong to department, department offers courses, students belong to department, etc. In this particular example, curiously, our department has a department number, as I mentioned earlier. Go back. Here is a department number. Department number is numeric, we said. This is an attribute of table faculty. This is not primary key. Primary key of this table is F name. Here is another table whose primary key is obviously department number. One electrical, one aero, two civil, three chemical, whatever, whatever, whatever. Okay. Department name and department location. Imagine that all the departments, a hypothetical academic institution where all the departments are located on floors. There's a huge 40 floor building. So department number 34 may be located on floor 7. Department number 58 may also be located on floor 7. Some department is located 41 floor, etc., etc. And these are the departments in which faculty members stay and work, because faculty members have an attribute called department. In this sense, faculty members are related to the department. The department number appearing as an attribute in faculty is actually the key for this table. So in fact, in a way, this table is actually an association with a table called faculty. We have not created a separate association by removing the department number to become. We have put the department number in that attribute itself. Why? Because we are saying a faculty member can belong only to one department. So there is no many-to-many relationship, so we don't need that diamond for representing that. Anyway, so you might want to just note down these three attributes and some of these attributes, because the next queries are based on that. So F name, F age, F salary, department number, and department number, department name, department location as the three parameters. Now we discuss further. Some values in a specified column. Some of the salaries of the faculty. Select some in bracket F salary from faculty. So this aggregate function will calculate the sum of all salary. Suppose you want to calculate the average salary, you can say select AVG salary, F salary followed by. Please remember that if for some reason some teacher's salary is null, that means that let's say the faculty member's promotion is under discussion. See, neither gets the old salary nor the new salary. Actually bad for faculty member, but whatever. If it is null, then what I'm trying to say is it should not be counted towards any averaging or summing. Find the average CPI of students registered for the course CS634 from Hostel 8. Select average SCPI from student, the comma reg, where student.sroll is equal to reg.sroll and C code is equal to CS634 and S hostel equal to A. Notice that I need a join because the hostel number of the student is in the student table, the course code is in reg table. The composite information I will get only if I do a natural join. This is the natural join condition here. And additionally, I want to have the course code to be CS634, this part of this. I can also say select average SCPI from student natural join reg, where C code is this and S hostel equal to it. Notice that the join condition which I had put in the where clause in the previous query, go back to the previous thing, where student.sroll equal to reg.sroll, this condition as part of the general predicate here is subsumed within this query when we say natural join. That equality is automatically implied. We now come to an extremely important part called subqueries. A subquery is a query which is first executed and gives the result of that subquery to a main query. It's like a subroutine. So you have a main program, you suddenly want to do something, you go to that subprogram, do it, come back with that result. Subprogram will always send back some result. So program subprogram is like a query, subquery. These subqueries are queries within a query. These are also called nested queries. A simple comparison predicate can involve a subquery. You can't write subquery as a completely independent thing. So that means in a query, you say select something from this, where. Now in where you are writing one or more conditions. In any condition, inside a condition, any one of the two parts of value expression can be a subquery. That means subquery, whatever values it returns, one or more, whatever, we shall see what, how to deal with more values, that replaces the value expression and then comparison happens. Let's take some examples. So value expression operator subquery is the format of writing the subquery. We try to answer a question, find names of students from hostel 8 who have CPI that equals maximum CPI in the institute. What we want to find out? Names of students from hostel 8. Select S name from student where S hostel is equal to 8. Where S CPI equal to. Why can't we write S CPI equal to max S CPI? Because max S CPI is not a value expression. Max is a function which is permitted to be used only in the select statement. It is not a mathematical function in that sense. It's an aggregate function. So consequently, max something can be evaluated only as a part of select something. So what I do now is, I write here, select max SCPI from student and put the whole thing in bracket. This becomes a subquery. The way SQL Engine will handle this is, it will look at this and recognize it's a subquery and it will execute as if it's a standalone query. So it will select max SCPI from student, it will get what? One value, then 9.78. Now it will replace that 9.78 here and then execute the larger query. So it will again go through the students where hostel is 8 and SCPI equal to 9.87, whatever. That's the purpose of subquery. Find the names and CPI of students registered for CS634. How do we get this? We know that the reg table contains the registration course code CS634. We also know the student table contains name and CPI. One way is to use the join. Okay. So select name comma S name comma SCPI. Okay, from student comma reg, where student dot s roll equal to reg dot s roll and course code equal to CS634. Alternately, because we have the notion of subquery, we can do the following thing. First, get roll numbers of all students registered for CS634 from reg. So don't do the join of two tables at all. I know that reg has 30,000 registrations, but CS634 has 85 students. So I first get out the list of these 85 and list of roll numbers of 85. I don't have names there. Now once I have this list of roll numbers of 85, I have a set on this side. Somehow I want to be able to say that now go through all the student table. If any roll number is equal to any one of these, that is, if any roll number from that student is in this set, print the name and CPI. You get the point? How will I write this query? Select S name comma SCPI from student where S roll in select S roll from reg where C code equal to CS64. Let's look at the subquery first. What is the subquery doing? It selects roll number from reg where C code is equal to CS64. Observe that this will not give a single value, not necessary. In fact, it may give null, no value, or it may give 85 values, depending upon how many students have registered for it. Please remember that this query is now giving you a set. Therefore, if I use the conventional comparison operators equal to, greater than, less than, they don't make sense. Those comparison operators will always compare one value and one value. Here, on the left hand side, I have one value, here S roll. I can say equal to this. There is a special word by SQL in SQL called in. Where S roll in this. So how this query will run? First, this subquery will be executed. A set of 85, 60, 75, whatever, those roll numbers will be collected by SQL. And now it will go through the main query execution. It will look at the rows of the student. And if that particular one roll number is in this set, then the name and CPI will be selected. This is not easy to explain from a relational algebra perspective, because in relational algebra, we did not have comparison of a value with a set. There is a relational calculus and tuple calculus which we are not discussing, which handles sets with the algebraic operation. So in is one of those. In operator is used instead of equal to when we have a set of values on the right hand side. In a nutshell then, I can write subqueries as part of an expression. The way you write it is inside a predicted, you have value expression, comparison operator, value expression normally. Instead you can say value expression, comparison operator and subquery. If the subquery gives you a single value, then you can use any one of those normal operators. If the subquery is going to give you a set, then you have to use in, and you can use not in, etc., etc. So please listen to this carefully. I am first defining the project one. This obviously is given in the context of IIT Bombay, so that you are all familiar with IIT Bombay. IIT Bombay runs several sponsored and consultancy projects. On these projects, project staff is appointed. This could be project engineers, project managers, administrative staff, whatever, whatever. Many a times, students are appointed on honorarium basis on the project. They're not called appointed, they're called associate. They work for 3 months, summer, winter, whatever, whatever. There are times when the student is passing out of the institute and is waiting for either joining a new job or taking up some doctoral thing or joining something else and says that, I have finished my this thing, so I'm a degree holder, but I would like to work as an employee only for 2 months, 3 months, whatever. Sometimes there is a project engineer working in project A. That project engineer has worked for 2 years. Within 2 years, that project engineer has learned something new and now aspires to be appointed on some more prestigious project B. The information about this project engineer was collected by the principal investigator of the project at the time of his appointment. Afterwards, what this fellow has achieved is not known, because there is no mechanism, there is no system. See, when you appoint people, you ask for applications. Physical applications come, you scrutinize them, and then you find out who are the eligible, you call them for interview, select them. Once you select, the dean R&D's office will religiously keep that biodata in a file and forget about. 2 years later, what has happened to that human resource is not known, except to the human. But there are 50 other projects who are probably looking for people with 1 year experience, 2 years experience, with this skill set, and without knowing that there are three such individuals in the same institute and two students who qualify with those specifications, this principal investigator will spend 50,000 rupees in an advertisement saying, "Ajao." So we would like to build a system in which the evolving information about prospective and existing employees on projects is maintained. And we would like this information to be maintained in a distributed way, meaning I don't put clerical staff, etc., etc., to key in information, update information. I let everyone update one's own information. Just like you do course registration. Earlier, the registration forms would be filled, they will be collected, head will sign them, academic office will enter them. Today, you all enter registration data online. What happens if you try to enter some bunkum data? It's supposed to be a faculty advisor who checks it or something. So you can put some validation process. Now, what we wish to do is to build a system, an information system. We don't know how to build that, by the way. We have not discussed the analysis and design and other things. We'll do that later. But the purpose here is to build a system wherein hundreds of prospective and existing, I would not say staff, human resources should be able to describe themselves in forms of parameters which can be queried upon later. The idea is that if I am a principal investigator of a project and if I urgently need someone with this specification, then I should be able to put the parameters of those specifications in a query in a screen. And I want a fellow with 5 years experience, a fellow who knows Java programming, who has done this, etc. Get me that. So this system will involve, first of all, the database schema design, how many tables you will have. We'll see how to do analysis and design of it. Then describing all the screens that you will put for querying, you will design all the reports that must be generated. When I make a query, I want a printed report which says the following six candidates, their location here, here, here are available. I might then want a system, another program, when I run this query, it will automatically generate an email to all the six fellows saying father wants people with this attribute. You seem to be so. Meet him at 10:30 on this Sunday. Please realize that in business information system, it is not just the collection or extraction of information we are talking about, but we are also talking about optimizing the workflow in any organization. Imagine that if you give me a software which will extract these names, and I will get these 6 names. Now either I will have to type the email looking at all the email addresses from there, or I will send physical notices to whichever hostels or wherever they are. Instead, if the information system itself automatically generates. For example, every time you make a submission on Moodle, as a teacher, I get an email saying this is my submission. One of the reasons why I am going crazy with my mailbox is I am getting 250 emails every day. So I don't know what to do with that. And suddenly between 10 emails here and 13 emails there, there will be an important mail from Ajay Chaudhary, who is the CEO of HCL. I just saw it. Or I would have missed it otherwise. Or I would have tested him for assignment. Now, so this is roughly the thing. Now, what I want you to do is, you have to choose only one of the two, by the way. And what you choose here may have no bearing on what the project you ultimately do. This is an exercise I am giving you on thinking about the requirement of an information system. I have given you a broad parameter. Now you apply your mind. You know the environment. Go talk to some project engineers or project staff members that you know. If you just walk into Tansa, you will see hundreds of them. Okay. And or in your department or whatever, and find out like what was the process, what were the parameter attributes they defined when they were called for interview. So at least you can say that okay, typically somebody wants to look at the following things. So like here we said name, CPI, etc. So name, address, telephone number, contact number, qualifications, etc., etc., etc. Make a list. And then we will form teams when the teams will compare these lists. What will this give you? This will give you an exhaustive list of all attributes that are likely to be important for this. Then we will design tables. You can see where we are going now. So I want you to do an exercise. At this time, you are not doing a business analysis or something. You are not doing a system analysis. But you are doing the problem formulation. What is the problem? You may think of variety of how will you collect the data? So what kind of screens will be required? What kind of reports will be required? Okay. What kind of logistics should be arranged? As I said, automatic generation of email. What kind of security will be required? What I suggest is write a generic thing and write something special that it occurs to you, either in security or in workflow or in data collection mechanism or verification mechanism or from a principal investigator's point of view, etc. Right? That's the task. Do not spend too much time on writing this, but I would expect each one of you to spend about 1 hour thinking and 1 hour writing. Assuming that you can write about 2 to 3 pages, typed pages in 1 hour, 1 hour of thinking and 1 hour of writing is good enough. The purpose is to think. And for God's sake, don't copy because it is meaningless. A, we will catch it immediately. And B, it doesn't serve any purpose. The purpose is that you think yourself. Doesn't matter if instead of 4 pages, you give only 1 page. I am willing to accept, by the way, a single line submission which says, sorry, I did not get time to think. Or worse, sorry, I cannot think. Okay. We'll figure out what to do with you when your CPI comes, but do it yourself is important. Okay. Second project. Now, this is an e-learning tool which will permit a teacher to create synchronous interactive learning material using multimedia resources. Let us take this example itself. What are you seeing on the screen? You are seeing the slide. Now imagine you are not here. You are in Jharsuguda. In Jharsuguda, you cannot see me. Here you can see me and the slide. The Jharsuguda fellow is able to see only the slide. But what appears on the screen is what that fellow away is seeing. And you can see the problem. That person sitting here physically can see me, can see this. But person sitting in Jharsuguda can only see either one of these two. Okay. Second, suppose I record all these lectures. What will be recorded? Today, actually what is going out onto the VSAT is getting recorded. What is going out to VSAT? Either me or the slide. And the intelligence of what is more relevant at any point is that fellow. He decides what the person in Jharsuguda sees, not I. I have no control over. Not Jharsuguda fellow also. He has no control. If he decides that that fellow should see me, he'll see me. Although he wants to look at the slide. And when he's taking down from the slide, suddenly he sees me. Now, that's not good, right? Second, so ideally I would like to see both the slide and the teacher. That is the correct simulation of a live experience. That alone is not a live experience. There is something else. Since I have digital technology, suppose now, as we are doing now, there is actually the mixing that is happening, but there is a camera which is actually recording all of me. So the entire video shoot of the teacher for the entire duration is available separately. The entire slate of slides is also available separately. The entire set of slides and the teacher talking is available in a synchronous manner because the audio is getting recorded. Now imagine the following. Can I switch to this? Suppose this is the screen and the Jharsuguda fellow is sitting in front of this screen. What he sees is very interesting. I want him to see. So this is the screen in front of which a student at a remote place is sitting. Ideally, what that student should see is on this large screen, there should be a small window, which is a video window. Constantly, the entire video of the teacher is appearing here perpetually. The audio is flowing along with the video. The student in Jharsuguda should perhaps see a slide. Don't you think this will be better than seeing either me or the slide? Now imagine such recording has been made. So now I have multimedia resources. Multimedia means multiple media, text, voice, audio. I have a slide resource which is a text resource. I have a video resource which is audio video resource. And I have the synchronization between slide and video based on when I push the next slide. This information is available, let's say, to my TA. Now I tell him, I want you to do the following. You have attended my lecture, you have also the composite video, so you know which slide comes when I am talking what. Go back, take all the collection of slides separately, take this audio video separately. Audio video has a timeline. Time t equal to 0, time 1 hour, half an hour, etc. Now, create an association between one slide and the corresponding video. Supposing this slide I start discussing 2 minutes 35 seconds after. At 3 minutes 10 seconds I change the slide. Now I say, prepare an index. 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. Each slide, if I click on slide 4, directly. When I start the session, ordinarily I will start seeing from point 1. But I want to go directly to slide 4. I will click on 4. Not only the fourth slide should come here, the video should advance to the point when I started discussing the fourth slide. I want a further addition. I want a modularization. Because ordinarily I won't even know what the hell was going on in slide number 48 or 34. So suppose I say that ordinarily there will be some logical grouping of slides in a lecture. So let's say I am discussing SQL, I am discussing subqueries, I am discussing application architecture. 3 to 7 slides may form a group. So I will say this is group 1, this is group 2. Group 1 comprises of slide 1 to 7, group 2 comprises of slide 8 to something. When I click on group, the first slide of that group should come and the corresponding video should come. In short, I want actually him to define a table which will say group number, then it will say text to be written here, then it will say start time and say video index or some such thing. Whatever, you can imagine. Basically, I want to correlate. Would you not agree that this would be a very useful learning material for a student even after the class is over. I want you to develop a system which will permit a teacher to construct this given the slide resources and video resources and the requirement that this is correlated at this point. That's the task. You can make it more functional by saying that I have, okay, now you can see this, I have, let's say, 50 courses. So I want to prepare a database in which all 50 courses are identified, and for each of the course I have 30 lectures. For each of the lecture I have these modules. What is the advantage? It is possible that course number 5 given by Professor Phatak on information system wishes to use a module of 5 slides which Professor Sudarshan is using in course number 37. So I don't have to redo anything. I pick up those slides, but the voice and video is mine. So I don't have to store the resources of these 5 slides separately. Then, when I release things in open source, I have a huge indexing capability. Tomorrow, instead of CDs and DVDs containing, let's say, anywhere between 780 MB to 4 GB, if I have 200 GB optical disk, then I can put onto that 200 GB all the audio video resources, all the database tables, all the SQL queries and the entire software representing that information system, give him that CD to insert, and that CD also boots, it has an operating system like Ubuntu, and the student can merrily look at anything that he wants. Why is this important? You see, we are trying to create an equivalent of a classroom. Please understand the limitation of the technologies. Technology might appear very jazzy to you. TV cameras, 2-3 cameras, etc., etc., and ability to show this, that, whatever. Do you know that in a classroom, ordinary classroom without modern technology, how many equivalent cameras are working? If there are 50 students, there are 50 cameras, because each student has eyes. Second, the focusing ability of individual human eye is same as the focusing ability of camera. Camera can zoom. We saw how it destroyed our attempt to write something meaningful there. Camera can zoom in, camera can zoom out. Suppose I am attending a course. Okay, it's a 1-hour lecture I am attending. Is it not very obvious that it is impossible for me for that entire 1 hour to be focused either on teacher or on slides or even combine both? Suddenly, sometimes when I am looking at a teacher, I may start getting interested in the pen. So my eyes will focus and I will immediately zoom the pen. It may happen for 3 seconds. Okay. There will be occasions when I will be looking at some colleague. This is the wrong place and time, but if there is nice greenery outside, I'll be looking outside. Even if physically my eyes are focused on the teacher, I might be looking through him. And each pair is controlled independently by independent mind. There's no way you can simulate that. If you really want to give an experience of a remote person, the remote person should decide that now I want to look at the pen. Just as you can, he can't. Please understand the difference. What we are attempting to do is forming a basis of a very rudimentary system which will try to come as close as an experience of a real life thing. 50 years later, there would actually be 50 cameras. In fact, today also there are technology demonstrations where we call immersive visualization. That means you immerse yourself into the environment. And depending on what you want to see, with what get zooming, you can actually do that. Because there are multiple cameras, multiple projection systems. We're not talking about that. Here we are talking about creating an e-learning tool which will permit a teacher to create synchronous interactive learning material using multimedia resources in the way I described on the slide. Additionally, if suppose Phatak's lecture for 1 hour is created, but if it is to be taught, let us say in Bangalore University, where Bangalore University wants to emphasize sub-queries more than what Phatak has done, then that teacher in Bangalore should be able to sit in front of a webcam, okay, shoot himself, not shoot like this, but I mean capture his image or video, permit him to have his own slides, and permit him to integrate his slides and his videos by replacing some slides and some video from me, from this course material which has been given. Then that course material can be said to have been adapted for Bangalore University. Don't you agree that just giving a recorded course material of IIT course is not as useful as permitting people to modify this course material as per the suitability of different universities and different colleges, because the emphasis will be different, example somebody won't like to make different. This will not be possible in the world full of intellectual property. I say, no, my slides. Okay, you can see them, but you can't touch them. That is why open source. And that is why the equivalent of a general public license, which in Creative Commons says, share alike. You are permitted to modify, but whatever you modify should be pulled back so that that is also available to somebody. Imagine now if on a cooperative basis, interested teachers from 2000 colleges come together and contribute these modules, the kind of digital contents that we can create could actually make students working as Eklavyas in some other place to benefit so much. That's the purpose. And towards this end, we are starting this. This is actually the kernel of a open source large project. For that, you might want to see site from the Rice University. This is called Connection, but Connection spelled with an X. Okay, Connection is a site where different people can contribute different modules. They are not necessarily audio visual. They could be, but they are different modules for in text for different subject segments. So there could be a module on networking, module on compilers, module on this. These are all contributed by different people. If I am a member of that consortium, I can say I am editing a book. And there is a tool which says, okay, this is the book. Which modules you want? This. Then it permits me to edit some modification. I can put some modification there. And then it actually prepares a printable book which can be sent to a printer and you can publish a regular book which will say edited by Professor D.B. Fatak. And modules contributed by this, contributed by this, contributed by this, etc. That's an excellent tool for text kind of module. Here we are talking of multimedia. So again, in this case also, think about it. This is not something which is of a common knowledge or experience to you. That's why I took slightly longer time to explain. Now, this is our imagination of the requirement. I would like you to think again for 1 hour, imagining further. What else can be done? And I would like to collect all 65 responses and maybe we will get, you know, 10 new brilliant ideas. At least 10 new ideas. Maybe 2 of them are brilliant. You know, they say that when you, out of 100 ideas, only 1 is brilliant. 99 have to be thrown out. That may be right, but I don't know which one. So I have to examine all 100. I have to generate all 100. I am expecting that distributed generation will happen. So choose any one of these 2 projects and submit it on the Moodle, a text description of whichever you say. Just write the project number, write then the description, and we'll get this, okay? And come prepared with the formation of groups of 3 to 4 students each, and select a group coordinator. We'll figure out a method of permitting the groups to be registered. The group coordinator must also submit a choice of either project 1 or project 2. Which groups will combine to form a 2 team shall be decided by me. Because in real life, you don't get to choose if you are working in Tata Consultancy Services. I said, I cannot say that I am interested in this project, but I will not work with him. I can only say I am interested in this project, and whosoever else is working. That's part of information system development. Okay, stop now. Thank you.